This project is supported, in part, by a grant from the Chatham Cultural Council.
There are many types of commercial fishing and many types of fishermen. This is a gillnet, the primary tool of a gillnetter. When set up to fish, it looks more like a badminton net than anything else. And though it takes a lot of skill and a fair share of luck to catch fish with one, the concept is relatively simple. The fisherman anchors the net to the ocean floor. Fish swimming along get stuck in the nearly invisible mesh of the net, hence the name gillnet. The fisherman raises the net and brings the fish back to market and to your dinner plate. This is a story of one of those gillnetters.
Everything told of the sea. Even when we did not see its waste or hear its roar. For birds there were gulls, and for carts in the fields, boats turned bottom upward against the house. Sometimes the rib of a whale was woven into the fence by the roadside. The shores are more fertile than the dry land. The inhabitants measure their crops, not only by bushels of corn, but by barrels of clams. Henry David Thoreau.
It is July 18th, early morning in Chatham, Cape Cod. This is the Dawn Tee, a gillnetter that is heading out today to the fishing ground known as Dwyer's, an area roughly 50 miles east of Chatham and a good deal west of George's Bank. Like most of Chatham's independent fleet, Cape Cod's proximity to good fishing allows her to take day trips of 17 to 20 hours in length. The captain of her four-man crew is Stuart Tolley.
Usually I'll tell the crew what time to be down at the pier, and I'll go out to the boat, I'll check the oil, I'll check the water, and bring the boat into the dock, and I have a fish hold. What they'll be doing is they'll be shoveling ice in the carts. You know, what we do is whatever gear we're bringing or food, generally I'll bring 5 or 6 nets each trip, replace the bad ones. And so we put those on the boat and we have our own food that we bring.
As the lights of the Chatham Fish Pier disappear at the stern, even navigating a familiar harbor requires a sharp eye. Stu has equipped the Dawn Tee with all of the latest navigational equipment. But he's been fishing for nearly 25 years now. long enough never to trust everything to just his radar and Loran. Sometimes there is no replacing your own eye and the fog-splitting beam of a trusty spotlight.
The times we leave each morning probably varies from, I'd say, 3 to 6 o'clock in the summertime. You have to deal with a few boats on moorings in the beginning of the way out. And after that, it's just, you know, buoys that mark the channel. And you gotta look out for a bar here and there. I like having the spotlight there also, but you never know. It might be something you're not picking up with the radar. It's probably a little assuring to see with the light.
On the previous day, the men on the Dawn Tee set their nets so that when they reach the fishing grounds, they'll be able to start hauling immediately.
And each end is marked with a big orange or yellow ball, and also a high flyer, which consists of a 16-foot aluminum pole with a radar reflector on the top end, which is picked up by our radar. I personally set 8 sets, each consisting of 10 nets. Now each net is 300 feet long, so I actually will have 8 3,000-foot sets out there. The majority of the time, as long as your catch has been decent, you want to pretty much put it back in the same place. So that makes it easier for all the boats, you know, to follow that same rule. If the catch isn't so good, you know, you may want to, you know, take it out and move it somewhere else. A lot of times you'll have to check with other boats, you know, do you have any gear over in this area? There are a lot of large dragger vessels fishing out of Gloucester, New Bedford. They come into our area. Setting the 8 strings will generally take anywhere between 1.5 and 2 hours. Sometimes I'll make 1-day trips or 2-day trips. If you're coming in on a specific day, then you know you'll have to time your setting and when you get done setting so you can make it into the pier to be able to unload, which is usually by 6 o'clock. So you'll be resetting, you know, before 1 o'clock in the afternoon to make sure you get in and unload.
Once through the dark fog of the harbor, Stu takes the first watch while the crew catches up on their sleep on the bunks below. The moon is the only light visible outside, but Stu has radar and radio weather reports to help him navigate.
The offshore marine forecast for George's Bank. Overnight, south winds 15 to 20 knots coming southwest. Local gusts to 35 knots possible thunderstorm, seas 4 to 6 feet, building to 5 to 8 feet. Visibility occasionally below mile in fog and scattered showers and thunderstorm.
The crew of the Dawn Tee will rotate in watches until they reach Dwyer's, which is a full 5-hour steam. The night before, they had only a few hours on land in between trips.
Definitely during the busy season, you have to take naps when you can. I've been doing more day tripping with the new regulations, you know, just trying to save on the days that we've been given for the year. So I would say they average 17 to 20 hours a day. So it doesn't leave you much time, you know, for when you're home to sleep. And you really need those 3 hours of sleeping on the way in and way out.
As dawn breaks out on the fishing grounds, the crew prepares to haul their first string and find out if yesterday's sets were made in successful locations. Stu locates his first set with the radar, and they watch for the first high flyer in the thick fog off the bow.
Usually arrive at the first flag and grab hold of the flag, and you know, we put the end of the buoy line in the hull and the ball will come up. I'll usually be coming out of the pilot house by then and taking my place at the wheel out back. We have a hydraulic hauler which hauls the nets. The nets will actually come over the side and a set of rollers and go into the hydraulic hauler, which actually pulls the nets up off the bottom. The amount of buoy line we use varies generally from 100 fathoms of buoy line to 150 fathoms. And at the end of the buoy line, we'll either have an anchor and a section of railroad track. The railroad track usually weighs about 80 pounds. Actually, on the other end, we'll have two railroad tracks.
They begin hauling back the first net, and as usual, none of them really know if there'll be fish there or not. Gill nets are used to catch many species of fish. The size and shape of the mesh determines whether a net is fishing for cod and haddock or for some other species. They are constructed of clear monofilament netting and secured to the ocean floor with the use of weights and anchors. The nets may be positioned in varying water depths, depending on the location of the species. Stu Tolley fishes his 80 nets in anywhere from 150 to 500 feet of water. And he also connects several of these nets together to form strings to increase efficiency. Looking at this dogfish, it is easy to see how fish are caught as they attempt to swim through the nearly invisible mesh. While untargeted species, such as juvenile cod, are able to swim through the netting, or if not, they are thrown back once hauled to the surface. Floats are attached every few feet to the top line to keep the net standing straight in strong currents. Weights and anchors secure the line to the ocean floor. Also, on each end of the net are buoys at the surface, which indicate the location and ownership of the gear and provide a line from which it is hauled. About halfway through the initial string, the first codfish breaks the surface. As more follow, the crew settles down to work. As long as the fish keep coming, there are no breaks. Each of them has their own job to do.
I'm primarily trying to stay on the gear. We do occasionally get hung up on the gear to the point where you actually part the lead line. So it's pretty important that the captain, you know, stand the gear as much as he can so it doesn't, you know, rip the mesh up. I don't usually distinguish between my first and second mate or the two crewmen that I usually have year-round. They generally know what order they're in, so I kind of leave it at that. But they pretty much share the main responsibility, picking fish and cleaning the fish and helping the man flaking the nets if he needs it. Depending on their experience, the crew members, I'll have one actually picking the fish out of the nets. We use what's called a pick. It's a small L-shaped object which has a handle and a little piece of steel coming out the end at 90 degrees. You just kind of work the monofilament mesh over the fish. Sometimes you pop meshes and sometimes you don't. I kind of get after the crew when they pop too many meshes.
Come on. I didn't pop anything.
My other year-round crewman, he'll either be picking fish or he'll be cleaning the fish. In other words, taking the heads off the larger ones and gutting them or just gutting the smaller fish. The fish that are over 10 pounds, we take the head off of. We take the head off of and then we gut them. And the fish that are under 10 pounds, we just take the guts out. As we do this, we'll put them into the fish box, which is located approximately in the center of the boat. During the summer months, I try to take a college kit for a fourth crew member. With the expenses of college, you know, I feel it's a good opportunity for someone to earn some money. You know, they work hard. And I put quite a few boys through college doing this. So, you know, I feel it's helpful to them. And the person I have now, he's fished with me the last two summers. And he's actually up at Boston University.
As the morning fog burns away, Stu pulls the last buoy on the string and takes the Don T over to the next set. Sometimes this gives them a chance to turn a bucket over and take a break before being called back to the rail.
Yeah, usually summer's mainly codfish. Probably like 95% codfish all summer. In the winter months, there are periods when we'll catch like a third haddock, a third pollock, a third cod. But, you know, overall we do target codfish. There are certain times of the year, not that I really care to target them, but if things are slow, sometimes we target dogfish, which are like a sand shark. Because of the mesh we use, it's pretty selective in the size fish we catch. There's very little discard as far as size of fish. There are discard, we'll catch a few skates. There's a few scalpins we catch. Yeah, we occasionally catch some lobsters. You know, we'll keep the good ones and we'll discard the females.
Boy,
They catch other types of fish too, like the yellow or orange ravenfish and the somewhat intimidating wolffish. Occasionally, they even pull up an errant jellyfish or starfish.
Starfish, starfish, starfish! Yes, starfish! We got a starfish!
Oh, we're a squirter.
The strangest looking of all, though, is the goosefish.
They're all head and mouth. They have a very large mouth on them. And I'd say 75% of their body is the head, and then they have the tail. They're a rather bizarre looking fish for someone who hasn't seen one. They have quite a lot of teeth. They're not large teeth, but they're very short and very sharp. And they probably have hundreds of teeth. They actually have two rows. There's a row way in back, too, so there are times when we've gotten our fingers caught in their mouth and trying to, you know, take the mesh out. You get quite a few holes in your fingers. Fish usually aren't everywhere. For gillnets to be most efficient, usually there has to be bait in the area. In other words, without the bait, sometimes the fish are just kind of grubbing on the bottom, and they might feel the net and swim away. When they're chasing bait, whether it's sand eels or herring or mackerel, we do much better because they're actually chasing after the bait. And it could, you know, they could be chasing the bait anywhere from right on the bottom to 20 feet off the bottom. Usually harder bottom is better, what we call harder bottom. In other words, not mud or not sand. Usually it will consist of some gravel. There's different growths on the bottom, what we call lemons or mussels. The depths range from, in the summertime, like generally 25 to 40 fathoms, which is 150 feet to 250 feet approximately. In the winter time, I'll go probably as deep as 70, 80 fathoms. 80 fathoms is approximately 500 feet. But you develop a sense for where the fish might be. Certain times when I haven't been for a while, I'll try different areas, maybe 5 miles apart. With my strings of gear, I may put, you know, two sets in one area and then go a couple miles and put another couple sets in and go a few more miles elsewhere. And so kind of spread my gear out trying to search for fish. Keep the fish finder on quite often. The only problem is it doesn't necessarily mean, you know, when you think you see fish, it doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to catch the fish or the size of the fish that you're looking for. I've had numerous times where I've, you know, come across what I thought would be large amounts of fish, and we've set the gear and, you know, come up empty. And what happens a lot of times is there's a lot of small fish which pass through the nets. You can't rely on it. I would say I rely on where the fish have been in the past. If you see fish there, you know, so much the better. I've had times where I haven't seen any fish and the nets have been full. So it's just another tool to use.
The Don T has caught about 3,000 pounds of fish today, just about average for a one-day trip. 2,000 pounds of cod is the regulated limit, and the additional 1,000 pounds consists of pollock, haddock, and other species. Stu makes note of the areas that fished well and those that didn't, and checks it against the success of the other fishermen in the Chatham fleet, 25% of which are also gillnetters.
I think everybody has a few other fishermen that they like to work with. Most of the boats have cellular phones, so a lot of the times, you know, more recently, we contact each other by cellular phone and keep it a little more private. It's more like a buddy system, you know, I'm going to tell you if we're doing good, if you tell me when you're doing good, and it works out well at times. So depending on the fishing, like I said, you know, whether you've already established an area where you're doing well or whether you want to move, is the time that you have most of your contact. You know, especially if you haven't been out and, you know, somebody else has been fishing, you'll want to know, you know, how they're doing or what they're catching.
Though Chatham is one of the smaller ports in New England, its codfish are highly regarded on menus in places like New York and Chicago, because boats like the Don T bring their fish in hours after being caught, whereas the large draggers take days to fill their holds. 5 hours on ice is all that stands between the ocean and the trucks at the pier.
After the fish are put away, the crew members will, we have scrub brushes, and I have 2 washdown hoses. So they'll scrub the blood and, you know, grime from the fishing day off the sides of the boat and deck, and pretty much wash down everything. After that, they'll come into the cabin, and depending on how tired they are, they'll either eat then, or they'll go take a nap and eat when it's, you know, their turn for watch.
Very little of the codfish is ever wasted. The heads will be sold to the Chatham lobstermen as high-quality bait for their traps. Before then, however, First Mate Chris Greco removes the cheeks from the codfish, a small pocket of flavorful meat which is consumed heartily in the seafood restaurants around town.
Other than filling in the log books, I mean, sometimes I'll go through some of my records, if, depending on how we did fishing, whether I think maybe I'll try a different area at some point, or maybe I'll go through an area and look on the fish recorder. Sometimes I'll purposely steam to a different area that I think might have fish. I'm always looking for fish on the bottom with my fish recorder, just to have different options if the fishing does decline. Thank you. The government requires us to call in each trip, and we receive a call-in number, and we have to do the same thing when we return to the dock. We have to call out and receive a number. These numbers go into a book, and we need to record the times in our logbook. Also the type of gear we use, how much gear we set, the depth, the land bearings where we fished, the type of fish we caught. Yeah, we unloaded the Chatham Fish Pier where they're boxed and iced. I believe the two companies, they'll try to sell as much fish locally as they can to the different fish markets. There's usually an excessive amount, you know, more than they can unload on the Cape Cod. What happens is the majority of the fish goes to Boston, New York, I believe sometimes Gloucester, where they have auctions. And the results of your day's fish, you know, won't be received until the next day after each auction. Gillnetting, through my experience, is a good fishery. I'd done the hook fishing. I did it in combination for quite a number of years. I could actually go dragging if I so chose to. As far as a way to be effective yet sustain the fish stocks, I believe gillnetting is an excellent way to fish. The passiveness of it, you know, on the habitat. I don't think we really disturb the habitat at all. We're pretty, you know, it's pretty passive fishing. The selectivity of gillnetting is very good as far as size of fish goes. You know, as much as a half an inch difference in mesh size makes an incredible difference in the size of fish you catch.
Hours later, and it all begins again. This time, they're heading out after daybreak. They'll be setting and hauling in pitch black out on the fishing grounds, and they won't be home until after midnight.
The part that's unique, I would say, about Cape Cod fishermen is that I think the fisheries have sustained themselves. I believe that the fishermen are doing as well, you know, currently as they have in the past. In fact, this is one of the best years I've had since I've been fishing. I see the future of fishing is doing fairly well. What I'm not sure is what management is going to do. Yeah, there's definitely an attraction or an allure of the ocean, being one's own boss, or even just, you know, being in the outdoors and making a living. As far as the fishing part, you know, other than my body feeling like it's starting to break down, the actual day-to-day process I find is going much easier, I'm sure, because of the experience that I have. As far as the future goes, that's a tough question. Well, I'm hoping my son takes over my boat.